Well, good morning. It is great to be back with you. My name is Lance Witt, and it's an honor to get to share with you this weekend, and I'm very excited about you guys having a new pastor. I got to listen to Craig Smith last weekend online, and it was wonderful to see the affirmation of the congregation, and I want to challenge you to pray for him and his wife and their family as they make the transition, even though they're not coming from a far distance. There's still a lot to learn, a lot to get up to speed on, and I hope that you'll pray for him and that you will follow his leadership. I really do believe that Mission Hill's best days are still ahead, and I'm excited for you. I also want to just take a moment to say thank you. I've spoken here several times over the last year, and you guys have been wonderful to receive me and always made me feel very much at home. And so I'm glad to get to share this last weekend that I'll get to share before your new pastor comes. So I want to begin by asking you a question. In your opinion, what's the most important word in the Bible? All right, now you can't say Jesus or God, but if you had to pick a word, I want you to get a word in your mind that you think is the most important word in the Bible. All right, share it with your neighbor right now, okay? What, in your opinion, most important word in the Bible? All right, so if I were to take the microphone around and interview the crowd, here's what I'm convinced. I would hear words like salvation, grace, gospel, maybe forgiveness or the cross, heaven, maybe the resurrection. I suspect very few of us would actually choose the word that I believe could be a candidate for the most important word in the Bible. And so this weekend, I want to be a bit of a tour guide and take you to some sites and stories where we see this word show up, because it weaves its way throughout the entire Bible. It's a word that we're very familiar with in Christian circles. We sing this word most every weekend. You hear it a lot when you hear Christians pray. And so it's a word that's very familiar to us. But I suspect if I took the microphone around, most of us would have a really hard time defining the word. The word I'm going to talk about is a word that summarizes really God's very essence. It's a word that expresses all that God is and all of his attributes. And I believe you could make a case for the most important word in the Bible being the word glory. Anybody else get that one? Oh, all right, good. All right. Not that the rest of you are wrong. I'm just saying, just in my opinion, in 1643, the English Parliament pulled together some of the greatest theologians and scholars of their day. And they asked these brightest minds of their day to wrestle with some of the top doctrinal questions, theological issues, and church practices. They met for 5 years in Westminster Abbey. And one of the documents that came out of those 5 years was something called the Shorter Westminster Catechism. And in the Shorter Westminster Catechism, the very first question they were asked to deal with is this question: what is the chief end of man? Now, you would think a group of scholars could write hundreds of pages on that question. But when they came back, their answer was 11 words. And 5 of those words were nothing more than restating the question. And their answer was, man's chief end is to glorify God and enjoy him forever. This distinguished group of scholars and students of Scripture said the ultimate purpose for which you and I exist is to glorify God. Now, if they're right, and that's true, then it's important for you and I, sitting here today in 2016, to understand, how do you glorify God? And what is his glory anyway? And so I want to take you on a little survey through Scripture, and I want to go back to Exodus chapter 24. And in Exodus 24, it's one of the earliest accounts where you see this word show up. And the Bible says that Israelites have now left Egypt and they're on their way to the promised land. And they've stopped at Mount Sinai. And Moses has gone up on Mount Sinai to receive the Ten Commandments. And the Bible says that the glory of God descended on Mount Sinai. And here's what it says in Exodus 24. To the Israelites, the glory of the Lord looked like a consuming fire on top of the mountain. So imagine this scene. God's glory settles on it. The people are in the camp down below. And the best way they know how to describe the glory of God is it looks like the mountain is on fire. And whenever you see the glory of God, especially in the Old Testament, it seems very mysterious. It seems hard to explain. It seems powerful, but it's always awe-inspiring. If you fast forward about 8 chapters to Exodus 32, Moses is still on Mount Sinai, and he's been there for a long time. And people down in the camp now are getting impatient and restless. And they're beginning to say, who knows what's happened to him? He may not be coming back. And so they go to Aaron, and they say to Aaron, would you build us some idols, create some gods for us that can lead us into the promised land? Now, Moses, contrast what's happening down in the camp with the rebellion and idol making. Moses is up on the mountain in the very presence and glory of God, and God is giving him the Ten Commandments, and he's writing these commandments on these two tablets, and the scripture says he is doing so with the finger of God. Now, God knows, obviously, what's happening down in the camp, and the Bible says that he becomes angry about the people's rebellion, and God says to Moses, I'm going to wipe them out, and I'm going to start over and build a whole new nation just with you. And you know the story. Moses prays, he intercedes on behalf of the people, and God says, okay, I'm not going to wipe them out, but I'm not going to go with you guys into the promised land. I know how rebellious you are. And Moses says, if your presence doesn't go with us, I don't want to go, because how would anybody know that we're your people if your presence doesn't go with us? And so God says, all right. And then here's what God says to him. I'll do the very thing you've asked because I'm pleased with you and I know you by name. And then in the very next verse, Moses makes this strange, bizarre, seemingly random request. It's like he says to God, okay, since I'm your favorite, show me your glory. Of all the things Moses could have requested in that moment, why does he ask to see God's glory? And what is his glory anyway? I mean, glory is kind of hard to define, right? It's not like defining a chair or a table or this podium. It's sort of like defining beauty. But it helps us to go back to the Hebrew, where the word kabod in Hebrew is the word translated glory, but its derivative means something that is weighty or heavy. And they used to use this word when they were talking about people of wealth. They would say that they were heavy with wealth. It's kind of like today when we talk about someone being loaded. And the idea behind the word is that God is loaded with the attributes of his power and splendor and beauty and honor. And so here's my feeble attempt to try to give us an understanding of what this word glory means. It's the manifestation of God's essence. It's the sum total of all that he is in his majesty, holiness, love, power, and beauty, and it's all put on display. And when you turn the word into a verb to glorify something, it means to make it big or famous or to give it great honor. So go back with me to Exodus chapter 33. Moses says, God, show me your glory. And God says to him, Moses, you don't really know what you're asking. No one can see the fullness of my glory. No human could be in the fullness of my presence and live. So here's what I'm going to do, Moses. I'm going to take you and I'm going to hide you in the crevice of a rock. And I'm going to put my hand over the rock. And then I'm going to pass by in all of my glory. And I'm going to remove my hand. And I'm going to let you see just a glimpse of the trail of my glory. Now, I don't care who you are, that's a strange passage, right? I mean, I don't know how you picture God putting his hand over the rock and passing by and what happens in that moment, but here's what we know to be true coming out of that moment. The glory of God comes down, meets Moses on Mount Sinai, and just seeing a glimpse of God's glory, Moses is literally transformed so that when he comes down off the mountain, his face is radiating with the glory of God. So much so that people freak out when they see him and they run and hide. And Moses ends up putting a veil over his face so that the people wouldn't freak out. All because he had this momentary encounter with this thing called the glory of God. Then you read something like Exodus 40 where the Bible says that the glory of God filled the tabernacle and it was so thick and so weighty, this presence of God, that Moses couldn't even get in. We read the word a little bit later when we go to Psalm 19, and it says that the heavens declare the glory of God. That tonight when you walk out into your backyard and you look up at the stars and the planets and you see the galaxies that are hung in the sky, the psalmist says that is God showing off, demonstrating all of his glory and beauty. Or this afternoon when you walk out of church and you feel the warmth of the sun on your shoulder, that's the glory of God. The warmth coming from this glowing ball of fire sitting in the universe 93 million miles away, close enough to sustain life but not so close that everything burns up, positioned perfectly so that life could be sustained here. And David would say, that's the glory of God put on display. And so you see it all the way through the Old Testament, and you ask, well, all right, what about when you get to the New Testament? Does the glory show up anywhere in the Gospels? And it absolutely does, but it looks quite different. It's not a mountain that looks like it's on fire. It's not, you know, the sky, but it's in the person of Jesus. John 1 verse 14 says, the Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. And listen to this, we have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. God takes the majesty of all of his attributes and he shrink wraps it and puts it in the body of his Son Jesus. Hebrews 1 says it like this, the Son is the radiance of God's glory and the exact representation of his being, sustaining all things by his powerful word. What comes to my mind is a ray of sunlight that comes from the sun. It's the same essence as the sun itself, but it's just in a more condensed or concentrated form. And that's what happens to the glory of God in the life of Jesus. The glory of God in Jesus is just in concentrated form. It's like when you go to Costco and you buy concentrated laundry detergent. It's more power in a smaller package, and that's exactly what we see in Jesus. And so Jesus is walking around on the planet with the glory of God inside of him. And then you have this bizarre story in Matthew chapter 17 where the glory of God leaks out. And so Peter, James, and John are going with Jesus on this little retreat up on the mountain. And when they get to the top of the mountain, the Bible says that Jesus is transfigured. His form and presence is completely changed right in front of their eyes. And here's what the Bible says. His face shone like the sun. His clothes became as white as light. And then appeared there before them Moses and Elijah talking with Jesus. And then here's Peter watching this, and then Peter makes one of the great understatements found anywhere in the Bible. Here's what Peter says. Lord, it's good for us to be here. No kidding. Like, you just got to witness something that nobody else has ever seen. And that is the glory of God leaking out, and Jesus' face shining, his clothes becoming white as light, and Moses and Elijah standing there talking to him. Now, it doesn't end there. When you go to the very end of the Bible, in Revelation chapter 21, the Bible talks about this place called the New Jerusalem, this heavenly city where you and I are going to live. And listen to what it says when it describes this city. The city does not need the sun or the moon to shine on it, for, listen, the glory of God gives it light, and the Lamb is its lamp. And so you see this word and this theme of the sum of all that God is, called his glory, that just runs all the way through Scripture. But what does that have to do with you and me? How does that impact how I think about my life, how I live on Tuesday as a Christ follower in this generation? Well, I want to take you to a couple of verses that will help us understand the impact. Colossians 1, verse 27 is where I want to go first. It's Paul writing, and he says, "To them God has chosen to make known among the Gentiles the glorious riches of this mystery, that God has revealed this mystery, and it is Christ in you, the hope of glory." There's that word again. Now, what he's describing is something that happens at conversion. If that's a word that's unfamiliar to you, what we're talking about is that moment when a person says, "I believe in Jesus. I believe he died on the cross for my sin, and I'm putting my faith in him as my Savior." And in that moment, the Bible says that you become a Christian and that Christ now comes to live in you. He begins to indwell you. And that happened for me when I was a 12-year-old kid. Now, all I knew when I was 12 and I accepted Jesus is that I got Jesus in that moment and my life had been forever changed. But as I've studied the Bible through the years, I've come to understand that in that moment when as a 12-year-old kid I received Christ, a lot more happened than I was aware of. The Bible says that in that moment I was transferred from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of light. The Bible says that in that very instant I was adopted into the family of God. The Bible says that in that moment I was forgiven and I was redeemed and I was given a place in heaven. In that moment, I was sealed by the Holy Spirit so that forever I am His. The chains of sin are broken in my life so that no longer am I in bondage to sin. And most beautifully, the glory of God in the person of the Holy Spirit comes to indwell you and me in that moment. So here's the difference between you sitting here today in 2016 and Moses on Mount Sinai when he encounters the glory of God. Here's the difference. The glory of God temporarily got on him, but for you, the glory of God permanently gets in you. Now, my friend, that is good news. Now, how big a deal is this? It's so important that one day when Jesus was talking with his disciples, he would say to them, "It is better for you if I go away." Now think about that for a moment. How could it possibly be better for Jesus to go away? What could possibly be better than having Jesus as your constant companion and friend through life? And Jesus said, "I'll tell you what's better. What is better is having the glory and presence in the person of the Holy Spirit come and indwell you permanently." And friend, that is a game changer. And I hope you're encouraged by that because it is an amazing gift that you have been given. And when Paul talks about this in Colossians, he says, "You have been given the hope of glory." And what he means by that is, in this life, you've been given just a small sample of what you're going to experience in fullness when you get to heaven. It's like the appetizer that you've been given in this life, because in this life, you're going to still struggle with sin and disease and pain. And someday you're going to die, but someday when you get to heaven, all of that is removed and you're going to experience God in all of His fullness and glory. So, I want to ask you, if you have your Bibles, I want you to open them to 2 Corinthians 3 because I want to show you two very important verses that relate to this topic and they relate to you. 2 Corinthians 3, beginning in verse 7. All right, when you read this verse, think of Exodus and Moses on Mount Sinai, getting the Ten Commandments. So he says, "Now, if the ministry that brought death, which was engraved in letters on stone, if that came with glory, so that the Israelites couldn't look steadily at the face of Moses because of its glory, transitory though it was." All right, stop there for a moment. What he's saying is there was this magnificent experience back in Exodus when Moses is on Mount Sinai, and he gets the Ten Commandments written by the finger of God, and the glory of God descends on that, and his face shines when he comes down off the mountain. But listen to what verse 8 says of 2 Corinthians 3. "Will not the ministry of the Spirit be even more glorious?" He says, as unbelievable as what happened in Exodus was, what you've got today in the person of the Holy Spirit living inside of you is even better. Now, skip down to verse 18. He says, now, we all right? So pay attention to that. We all of us. If you're a Christ follower, this isn't for super Christians or theologians or missionaries. We all, with unveiled faces. So Moses had the glory which was going to fade, and he needed that veil. And he says, we don't wear veils when it comes to the glory anymore. And then he challenges us to contemplate the Lord's glory. And then he says, we are being transformed into his image with ever-increasing glory, which comes from the Lord who is the Spirit. So here's the question I want to ask you. How long does it take to become a Christian? A moment and a lifetime. When I was 12, there was that moment when I was converted and I became a Christ follower and I became a Christian, but I'm spending the rest of my life trying to now become conformed to his image and become more and more like Jesus. That's why Martin Luther says, a Christian is never in a state of completion, but always in the process of becoming. And that's what Paul says when he uses the word transformed. We are being transformed. It's the word metamorphosis. We are being changed day by day into his image with ever-increasing glory. From the inside to the outside, the longer we walk with God, the more his glory takes hold of us and we begin to reflect more of his glory in our lives. What ought to be true is that the people of this community ought to see more glory in you this year than they did last year. Because you're becoming more like Christ. The longer you walk with him, the more you are in his word, the more you understand him, the more you obey him, the more glory shows up in your life. All right, so let me give you three takeaways that are practical for you as you walk out of here today. All right, number one is, learn to contemplate the glory of God. So what does it mean to contemplate there in verse 18? It means to ponder or think about, linger over, to soak in it. And you know what I'm learning the longer I walk with God is you can't contemplate in a hurry. You can notice, you can glance, you can look, you can scan, but you can't contemplate in a hurry. And yet for most of us, our lives are very much in a hurry, compulsively busy. I brought a couple of photos that I think are a bit of a metaphor for how we live in our generation. So here's the first one. We live in a jet ski wave runner kind of world, right? There's nothing as exciting and an adrenaline rush like, you know, flying across the top of the water at 40 miles an hour, wind blowing through your hair. Well, for most of you, wind blowing through your hair. My wife and I recently did a little vacation with some friends. They have a lake house up in Lake Winnipesaukee in New Hampshire. And we got on the wave runners. And I got to tell you, I love it. And I think it's how we live. We love the rush of a fast-paced life. We love the adrenaline and exhilaration of doing a lot. But here's what I want you to understand. You will never go deep with Jesus if all you do is rush through life on the surface. Nothing wrong with jet skis, but it's not all that God meant you to experience. There's another experience he wanted you to have, and it's this. It's underneath the surface. It's slower. It's quieter. And there's a whole world that opens up to you in scuba diving that you never see when you're on a jet ski. And part of the discipline of the Christian life is learning to slow down enough to actually be with God, to spend unhurried time with God in his word, and to be present with him. And again, if I'm honest, I would tell you that's a real struggle for me because all my life I've been sort of driven type A. I like being busy. I like being productive. And so the idea of slow and quiet and contemplating feels very challenging. So I have a good friend that he was diagnosed with cancer. He's an executive pastor up in Canada and is quite serious, and he was out for a while. Took a leave of absence. In fact, I went to help their church for a little bit while he was out. And the treatment worked. Our prayers were answered. His cancer went into remission. And when he came back, he and I sat down and had lunch. And I was anxious to talk to him. So I said, hey, you didn't know if you were going to live. You've been out all this time. You've had a lot of time to think and be with God. What is it? What's the big lesson you got during these 6 months that you were out? And without any hesitation, here's what he said to me. Hurry destroys relationships. And I've always remembered that. Whether it's your marriage or a friendship or your walk with God, always being in a hurry, skimming across the surface, will eventually destroy it. There's a woman you probably never heard of, but she was famous in France. She was only 33 when she died. It was the year 1943. But she was known as a great woman of prayer who had a deep connection with God. And when she died, the French government issued a postage stamp in her honor. Her name is Simone Veil. And on it, at the bottom right in French, is a little statement that she was famous for. And here's what it says. Attention is the only faculty of the soul that gives us access to God. Only as you learn to slow down and pay attention can you really know God. I think that's what David was saying in Psalm 27 when he said, one thing I ask from the Lord, this only do I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze on the beauty of the Lord and to seek Him in His temple. Just to know God deeply. So you see, when you go to your Bible, it's not just to get information. It's not just to learn new truths or to get smarter in the Word of God, but it's also to raise your affection and help you to love God more deeply. So learn to contemplate the glory of God. Here's number two, walk in humility. I think that contemplating the glory of God will lead you to a healthy fear and reverence of God. Occasionally, I will meet a Christian who will talk to me about going to heaven, and here's what they'll say to me. You know, I can't wait. When I die and I finally get to heaven, I'm going to run up to the throne of God and jump up in the lap of Jesus. And I say to them, I'm not so sure that's how that's going to play out. Because when you see people in Scripture who have this encounter with God, what happens is they usually fall on their face in reverence before God. That's what happens in Exodus 34 when Moses sees the glory of God. He bows on the ground and he worships. Or in Isaiah 6, it says that Isaiah saw God high and lifted up. And then here was Isaiah's response. It's over. I'm doomed. I am a man of sinful lips. I have filthy lips and I live among a people with filthy lips. Doesn't sound like he's jumping up in Jesus' lap to me. Or how about Revelation chapter 1 when John has the curtain of heaven pulled back and he sees the glory of God. The Bible says that John fell on his face as though he were dead. And I think one of the things that is helpful about contemplating the glory of God is that it reminds me that God is big and I am small. And it reminds me that He is not some kind of cosmic vending machine who is here to make my life easy and happy. The truth is, I exist for Him. He doesn't exist for me. And I think one of the things that is true about every Christian that is healthy is that we hold two things in tandem. In one hand, we hold this reality that I am broken. And I've walked with Christ for more than 40 years, and there are still things in my life that are broken, and I still struggle with, and I get defeated by on a regular basis. And it's discouraging and frustrating sometimes that I can't get victory over certain things. And I'm aware that even after all these years, I still am broken, but also I am blessed. And in spite of my brokenness, I am accepted. I am loved, that God sees me as valuable. He considers me precious and He cherishes my relationship with Him. And I live with both, but part of it is this recognition that I am broken and that He is this majestic, holy God, and I want to walk in humility and recognize that. You see, God is protective of His glory. He won't share it. Isaiah 48 says this, For my own sake I do this. How can I let myself be defamed? And then listen to this phrase, I will not yield my glory to another. God will not share it. God would say to us this morning, I am the center of the universe. I have created you, and I've created you so that you would exalt me and make me famous. All right, here's the last thing, and then we'll wrap up. It is to serve God with bodacious boldness. So if you go back to 2 Corinthians 3, verse 12 says, Since we have such a hope, this hope of God's glory, we are very bold. Now, I've thought a lot about this passage in preparing for this message, and here's the question. What does God's glory have to do with me living boldly? Well, here's my best shot at answering that. If God's glory is real, if what happened on Mount Sinai is real and the mountain looked like it was on fire with the glory of God, and if Moses had this momentary encounter with a glimpse of God's glory and his face literally radiated with the glory of God, and if the heavens are God's glory put on display, and if Jesus was God's glory walking around in human form, and if heaven is not going to need an electric power plant because it is lit up by God's glory, if all of that is actually real and true, then I can live with confidence and boldness. Because my God is real. He is large and in charge. And by the way, he is not sitting up in heaven today wringing his hands, worried about who is going to win the election. And we don't have to either. And in fact, all the craziness and chaos of the world in which we live is a call for us to live more boldly, because the light of the gospel always shines most brightly against the backdrop of evil and chaos and sin. And so my challenge to you is follow God boldly. Pray boldly. Share your faith boldly. Serve others in Jesus' name boldly. Because his glory is real. And here's my final challenge. It's one verse, 1 Corinthians 10:31. So whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do it all for what? The glory of God. You know what I love about that verse? It's not about some super spiritual event or a worship service or a mission trip. Paul says, in your everyday common life, on Tuesday afternoon when you make decisions and while you're at work or when you're with your family, in your everyday normal mundane routine of life, do everything you do for the glory of God. The chief end of man is to glorify God and enjoy him forever. May that be true of you this coming week. Let's pray together. Father, thank you for your glory. In our finite human minds, we can't really comprehend all that that means. But Lord, we know it's beautiful. It's full of splendor and majesty. It's everything that you are. And I pray that like Moses, you would just give us a glimpse of that. And thank you that you have put the Holy Spirit, you have put your glory in us. Thank you that you showed us your glory in Jesus. And I pray that today, that as we walk from this place, that we would begin to know you more deeply, that we would walk in humility, that we would have greater boldness, and that people would see more of the glory of God in us this year than they did last year. Lord, it really is our heart's desire to make you famous in this community and in our world. And may it be so in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Lance. We have an opportunity now to put God's glory on display and to shine a light into the lives of people here in our community. We take what we call our watch care offering. It's a chance for us to give to those within our community who have severe financial needs. Just know that as you give today for this watch care offering, that you might be making a difference in the life of someone who might be actually just sitting right next to you right now. Let's glorify God through our giving and through our support of one another in this community.
Before the world was made,
Before you spoke it to be, you were the King of Kings. Yeah, you were, yeah, you were. And now you're reigning still, enthroned above all things. Angels and saints cry out, we join them as we sing. Glory to God, glory to God, glory to God forever. Glory to God, glory to God, glory to God forever. Yeah. Creator God, Creator God, you gave me breath so I could praise your great and matchless name. All my days, so let my whole life be a blazing offering, a life that shouts and sings the greatness of our King. Glory to God, glory to God, glory to God forever.
Good morning, Mission Hills. My name is Tim Mullenpaugh. I'm one of the elders serving Mission Hills this year, and with me is my wife, Michelle, who serves women's ministry as a prayer coordinator. So last weekend was a pretty big weekend here at Mission Hills Church, and I'm proud to report that 98% of our members voted yes for Pastor Craig Smith to be our new senior pastor, and he will start, yeah, amen. So Pastor Craig's going to start September 10th and 11th, and that'll be a pretty big weekend around here with an installation service. There'll be a lot more information coming out to you in the next few weeks. Between now and then, there's actually exactly 40 days before Pastor Craig gets here. Now, 40 is a pretty special number in the biblical times. And so what we would like to do, the elders and the Mission Hills Church staff, we'd like to invite you to join us in 40 days of prayer, praying using this prayer guide, which you can get on your way out. The ushers will be handing them out. You can get them at the Welcome Center. And if you're kind of a techie, you can go online at missionhills.org and actually sign up, and you'll get remember emails to help you on your journey in praying over the next 40 days. Pray that God will really lead Pastor Craig will shepherd our body, will open our hearts to what God wants to do in our lives here as a body of Christ. So we'd like to start this 40 days with a prayer.
Would you please pray with us? Dear Lord, we thank you so much for this day. We thank you for our church and all that you have blessed us with in the past 15 months of this journey of looking for a pastor and a shepherd to lead our church. We thank you for the message today on the glory of God and how that really does teach us and impress upon us to draw closer to you. In Jeremiah 29, it says, "Then you will call upon me and come and pray to me, and I will listen to you. You will seek me and find me with all your heart." I pray that would be the case for our church, that we would really diligently take these 40 days of prayer and that we would seek you, Lord, that we would really find you where we are, that you would bless us and take care of us in this coming transition with Craig Smith.
Lord, we give you thanks for what you have blessed Mission Hills Church with. We're thankful that I believe it's only our fifth senior pastor in the history of Mission Hills Church. God, bless this church. God, I pray that you will quicken our hearts to look to your face, to see your glory. We pray, God, for the weeks and months ahead that you will really work in our lives and that we will open our hearts to hear what you have to say. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.